Today we're going to be working on another dead MacBook. This here is an A1706 MacBook that's not turning on. Let's see if we can make it turn on. Look at this pretty MacBook. So, we have the battery cable unplugged, and the battery unplugged as well. We're going to see how much amperage this machine is using. So I'm going to take my USB-C charger and USB-C ammeter, available on store.rossmangroup.com. And the first thing we notice is that this has been screwed with by an idiot. Let me show you how we know this. Check this out. So when we zoom in on this beautiful, lovely, optically stabilized camera, yeah, beautiful stabilization in our studio. See how it's moving? Either the port is not screwed into the board, or it's screwed in using the wrong screw so it wasn't able to go in all the way, or it's screwed in halfway. This is lazy shit. Very lazy shit. Anyway, so let's see how much power this thing happens to use. So it looks like we're drawing 20 milliamps at 5 volts, and it looks like it is boot looping. Okay, we're going to have to figure out why that's the case. So let's take this thing apart and go from there. I've got Weird Al Yankovic stuck in my head now. That song is... Damn it. I'm never gonna get that song out of my head now. Damn it.
So alike in every way, I gotta say. In fact, I just thought I might pop the question there that night. I was kissing her so tenderly, but woe is me.
iPhone 4.
Who would have guessed her family crest? I'd suddenly spy tattooed on her thigh, and son of a gun, it's just like the one. Kids with 11 toes and move to Alabama.
never have my colon irrigated. No, no, no. I was.
Why'd you have to go and make me so constipated? Why'd you have to go and make... I'm gonna play that song next time somebody sends me Indian food. Hopefully no more. For a while. For the amazing music, keep it coming. Don't give it to me, Eric Sanchez. Give it to Weird Al Yankovic. When Al pulled the Michael Jackson parodies. No. Abdullah donated $50 to Super Chat. Holy shit. Thank you. I didn't even have to wear a fursuit. Speaking. Why'd you have to go and make me so constipated? It's a party in the CIA. Okay, so this is screwed in. It's just screwed in very lazily. So that screw is there. Thank you, Abdullah. Lizzie. Okay. I did not deserve that of Mr. Abdulaziz, but thank you. $600 to replace Surface Book 2 screen. Kappa's in the chat, please. Kappa? What's a Kappa? I don't know what type of screen the Surface Book 2 uses. I would imagine it's not cheap, just because from what I've heard, it uses a 3:2 aspect ratio. Good luck finding that stuff anywhere. It must have been a special made LCD for them, and it also wouldn't have been a large run, because as many of you may know, nobody purchases the Surface. I've yet to see a Surface in real life. Okay, so here we have the MacBook. Now we're going to turn it around and take a look at the board really closely. And let's see if any of you can tell me what you think is wrong with this MacBook. From this beautiful high-resolution image that I got from that nice $250 used, got on eBay, flash doesn't even work on a camera that I'm using as my overhead. What do you all see? Let's see, I'm kind of curious if that's actually... Yeah, we got some more light. So I can lower ISO. Can you all see details? From the overview? I mean, I can see it from here. I'm just kind of curious to see if you can see it. I'm also kind of curious if I should change the camera mode to auto at this point. See what program auto's got to say. Yeah, so that's auto. Alright, what do you all think? Liquid damage right side. Ooh, good catch. Okay. Let's take a look at that right side and see what we get. What do we see now? I can't set the white balance on the camera because the damn button over here is broken. Oh, there we go. Okay. So, that is some liquid damage over here. Now, this cap is usually the one that winds up shorting PP3V3_G3HOT to ground. One of the things that I've gone over in many of these videos is that you need PP3V3_G3HOT to be present in order for the charger, for the USB-C port controller to be able to turn on, and that has to, the USB-C port controller has to communicate with the charger in order for the charger to put out 20 volts instead of 5 volts. So as you saw in this beginning of this video, we were only getting 5 volts, not 20 volts, on the USB-C charger. And I was able to confirm that with this USB-C amp meter that you can buy on store.rossmangroup.com, which I'm actually going to be shilling more than usual because we just recently lost $1,800. So we are going to be seeing what it is we can do to, I mean, looking at the schematic for this board using Paul Daniels' lovely software available at pldaniels.com. So if this over here is a USB-C port controller, and the voltage in that goes into this for it to work and turn on, you look over here, VIN, VIN. VIN is not like a VIN number on a car. It stands for voltage in, 3V3. If we follow that, it goes to PP3V3_G3HOT. PP3V3_G3HOT needs to be present in order for us to get this chip to work. And this chip needs to work in order for us to get 20 volts rather than 5. So let's see what voltage we are getting there. By using the multimeter, we're going to turn on Paul Daniels' multimeter software. Big thank you again to Paul Daniels at pldaniels.com for providing us with this multimeter software that allows everything that I show you on the everything that I put on the meter to be visible on screen on the stream. Okay, so we are going to turn this on. Meter software. And let's see what we get on our PP3V3_G3HOT. I want to make sure I'm actually touching the cap and not just the underfill on it, so I had to scrape it a little bit. Now, as you can see, we're getting 0 volts. So the next thing I'm going to want to do is see if there's a short to ground on PP3V3_G3HOT, because a short to ground could cause that power rail to not turn on and not function. So let's see what's going on there on this capacitor. 11 kilo-ohms. It's hard to touch the actual cap here. Alright, so the short to ground is not what's causing this to not be present. Interesting, interesting. Good stuff. Okay, so next thing we're going to do is find the circuit that creates our power rail that we need that's missing, the PP3V3_G3HOT. So let's see if we could find the PP3V3_G3HOT creation IC. This is PP3V3_G3HOT going into something. That's it going into something. Going into something, 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 that's it going into something. That's it coming out of something. Here we go. And over here, this is the chip that's going to create our PP3V3_G3HOT. So let's check it out and see where it is on the board. And also, Let's see if it's actually being told to turn on. So here we have U6903, and over here you can see there's many different pins. We have mode, sup, boost, out, bias, looks. So let's just go over this and try and buy some vowels. So sup, supply. That's going to be the voltage coming in from either the charger over here, PPDC and charger, or the battery. Because remember, this rail has to turn on first. Boost. I don't know, maybe that's beast mode or something. N, enable. Here we go. So I need voltage on pin 10 for this to turn on. So let's see what we got on pin 10. Let's try to get this thing into beast mode. Okay. So we find ourselves that on the other side of the board. Device unrepairable, need to buy a new one for $3,000. You GTFO my stream, Apple genius. Get the F out of my store. You are not welcome here.
Get the fuck out of my store. We are closed. Get the fuck out of my store. We are closed. Get the fuck out of my store. We are closed.
GTFO my store. Mofo. Okay. Next up. Hmm. 5 volts on enable. Interesting. Double check that. The enable is there. So whoa, okay, you just jumped. Oh, my hand slipped. Okay, so we got a steady 5 volts on the enable. Now for the supply, supply is going to be pin 2, which is going to be on the bottom. Close to 5 volts from the chargers coming in. Alright, next thing we're going to do is let's take a look at the output and just make sure that I'm not getting it. So R6915 is going to be where this is output to the rest of the machine. Let's switch back over here and see what we get on R6915. Interesting, it actually is present. It just wasn't present on that particular capacitor. PP3V3_G3HOT is there. Yet I wasn't getting it when I was measuring it on that capacitor earlier. So let's double check. Perhaps I didn't scrape away enough of the underfill when I was measuring, and that caused me to look like an idiot, wasting 5 minutes of time on what should have been fairly simple. Yep, I didn't scrape away enough. So we are stuck at 5 volts, and if I had to guess, it's going to be something in this area because this is corroded. Now, I'm not sure if the chip is dead to blame here. Because this is underfilled, you may be able to tell that there's this stuff around the chip. See this on the left side? See that? So the chip itself is sealed. So I'm inclined to blame any one of those components on the left or the right side that's filled with corrosion. Nisera is here. Shanare. I actually forgot how to pronounce most of these things because it's been a while. I hope you fixed your MacBook Air. And you better open a repair service in Sweden, else you're going to make our educational streams look bad. Ew. Steve is spitting out a loogie in the bathroom. Okay. So let's take a look around that chip. Samuel, it's only worth it if you're able to buy them at cheap prices. You have to do what Steve used to do and convince people to sell them to you for like $100. Okay, so let's see what these resistors are. That's a pull-down resistor to ground, don't care. 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 Okay, that's 3.3 volts, something for a DisplayPort aux channel. None of that stuff is really going to be relevant to me. Because if you think about it, why am I going to express grave concern for the fact that DisplayPort isn't working when I don't even have it talking to the charger yet? So let's see what happens if we just get rid of that corrosion with some mild reflow and flux. Now do keep in mind, this chip over here is underfilled. If I heat up if I heat up the solder balls enough that they start to melt, they're going to expand, and once they expand with the underfill there, there's no room for them to go, everything's just going to explode out into a big mess. So I'm going to want to use a temperature that's going to clean that area, but without actually melting the solder balls. And you can get the flux to activate at a temperature that's not necessarily going to melt solder, which is what we're going to try to do here, using the Quick 861DW, available at store.rossmangroup.com. Don't delay, buy today. So we're just going to lower the temperature on my Quick 861DW, available at store.rossmangroup.com. Don't delay. Buy yours so that the post office can lose it and fuck Lewis over today. Okay. What is underfill made of, someone asks? Underfill is made of the tears of technicians. Hardened over time. Pierinov is here. High IQ has made it to the chat today. How is it going, Pierinov? Now remember, our goal here is not to melt solder, because if we're melting solder, then that chip is going to be even more screwed up than it likely already is. Hot air is essential for board repair, someone asks. Yes, it kind of is. You need it. Thunderbolt chips don't get messed up too much without water damage, Cafe, but the CD3215's Thunderbolt, this specific one does. So overall, Thunderbolt chips, no, but there's a lot to the Thunderbolt circuit. So the hall sensor on the right is going to need a little TLC. I get donor boards from the internet. If you had time, what college classes would you have an interest in taking? History. Probably history. Please accept this small percentage of your annual revenue as a thank you for providing not just endless hours of entertainment, but education too. I do not do component-level repair, but I have dabbled with soldering. Your videos have taught me a lot. Thank you very much, Keith Birch. I highly appreciate your dollar. Thank you. Okay. Let's see if we've made any progress. So I'm going to plug it in. No progress. That CD3215 is likely dead. We are going to replace it with a better one. Let's remove that underfilled CD3215. Hey, I noticed your soldering got sloppy lately. Not enough flux. Remember, the bigger the glob, the better the job. I'll make sure to let Paul know. The bigger the glob, the better the job. Speaking of the bigger the glob, let's increase our temperature, the temperature that will remove this chip. Actually, let's see if there's an X-Acto knife back here. Are there any X-Actos back here?
Yeah.
Or should I just scrape this thing off with tweezers? Tweezers it is. Oh, cool. Yeah, might as well remove some of this. Thank you. Move some of this junk around it. Rip this thing off. Making some minor incisions. We have a new follower, S2006EW. Thank you very much for following on Twitch. Now this chip is going to get removed from the board. Now, see, I try really hard to remove it up rather than to the side because I don't want anything on the side to get messed up. Now we are going to try and remove as much of that nasty underfilled junk on the bottom as we can. Let's do it. Now, melting that stuff off can be a pain. Removing that stuff is a pain in the ass. So I like to just use some flux and desoldering braid. The desoldering braid is really good at removing that stuff. Someone says asterisk for president. I'd vote an asterisk in for president. Probably wouldn't cause me to lose thousands of dollars in tariffs that they don't post to their own website. Okay. Are there any cutters back here? More than one, maybe? That's asking too much. Alright, no worries. Yeah, see how the braid really helps remove that stuff without me having to scrape all day? The desoldering braid is not just good at picking up excess solder, it's also really good at removing this trashy underfill. Just destroys it. Just plows right through it.
Lewis?
Yes, sir.
Can you mute for a second?
I mute? Okay, one moment. Just a bit important business. Hello. Okay. Let's take a look. What do you have?
Sure, so.
And what is wrong with it?
Disgusting.
So you said it doesn't turn on anymore?
Yeah. I went to bed with it on, and it was functioning fine. It charged my phone and everything. And then I woke up in the morning. I just put it on a table, and then I went to go plug it in, and I noticed that the mag light wasn't going on. It wasn't going green. And then I tested this with another laptop, and it did turn it on. But it's
thank you, Vicky Shore.
Not charging, and won't turn on.
All right, give me 1 second. Let me just take an intermission from this one, and no worries. Okay, we'll get back to that one in one moment. Anonymous gave $2 for a bunch of asterisks. Thank you. No daily disclosure. I also offer that service to when my accountant stuff, including my records, are on a machine that is now dead. Yeah. Eric is here. How's it going, Eric? Green light and charger, 11 milliamps usage, G3 hot, stumbled over your channel last year and I'm really enjoying your content. Any chance of more bike videos? I want to do more GoPro live streams. The problem is the GoPro never works for live stream. I may just do more from my phone. What I need to get is a phone holder for the bike that allows me to put the phone in landscape. Because my phone holder only works in portrait on the bike at the moment. Is it someone's birthday today? Please wish my wife, Manali, happy birthday. She's watching right now. Happy birthday, Mrs. Manali. Oh, wait, no. You're Mickey Shore. Your wife's name is Manali. Happy birthday, Manali. I hope you have a good birthday. Still nothing after unplugging keyboard. Speaking of tariffs, we have the same problem here in Czech Republic. There is universal, you might pay, but we will not tell you what for. Packages, especially from China, are totally excluded, while Australia is heavily tariffed with a 21% handling fee. I'm kind of curious, why Australia? Why the hate on Australia? Now, I would understand hate on Australian software. I mean, by all means, Australian software, you don't want to let that... You definitely don't want to let any board view programs from, you know, from Australia enter your country. But I don't understand the rest. Okay, let's see what we have on the other side of this board. Plug this in. Thank you so much, says Vicky Shore, for 1,000 Thunderbolts. PP3V42 is present. PP bus is present but low, meaning the SMC is not turning on, meaning it's an SMC issue or an SMC reset issue. Is SMC reset high or low? SMC reset is 1.44 volts. So we have an issue with SMC reset circuit or SMC. All right. Let's remove SMC reset chip, and if we remove the SMC reset chip and SMC reset is high, we're lucky. And all this board would need is an SMC reset chip. If we remove the SMC reset chip on this board and it doesn't work, that means the SMC is pulling it down. So, and I will go over the why of that the moment I remove this chip. Okay, chip removed. So let's just open up a schematic and a board view for the 820-3536 that this is, so I can show you all what's going on there. 8203536. Now, there's no green light in the charger. And in order to have a green light in the charger, what set up. Oh, weird out. Not now. Okay, in order to have a green light on the charger, I need for PP3V42_G3HOT to be present. PP3V42_G3HOT is what's going to allow this chip to work. On a highly serious note, I'm looking to build my digital portfolio further. I was wondering if I were to create scene animations for you in OBS, would you consider this? And if so, how can I message you privately? Lewis@RossmanGroup.com. That's Lewis@RossmanGroup.com. Send me an email. So here, this chip is going to pass PP3V42_G3HOT to this chip. This chip is going to take the adapter send signal and send it over to the system management controller on the SYS1 wire line. SYS1 wire here is going to go to the SMC chip. That's what's going to turn the charger on. Now, our charger is not turning on right now. The charger, as you saw, is not turning green or orange. The SMC itself is going to turn on when SMC reset L is present. SMC reset L is a signal that's going to keep the SMC from trying to turn on before all the power rails have stabilized. This chip is going to keep SMC reset L low for maybe like 200 to 200 milliseconds. Think of it like a brownout detector. It's just going to make sure that PP3V42 is exactly 3.42 volts before it turns on. Now, there's two ways I can tell before I even measure SMC reset L that the SMC is off. The SMC doesn't just communicate with the charger. It also communicates with the chip that creates the voltage required for the machine, U7100, which is going to create PPBus G3HOT. See over here, we have an SMC data line over here, the data line, the bidirectional data line speaking with this chip, and this chip is creating PPBus G3HOT at the wrong voltage. It's creating it at 12.23 rather than 12.56, and it usually creates it at 12.56 when the SMC works, 12.23 when it doesn't. Oh, thanks. Thank you. So let's see what we get over here. Now that we have turned off we've removed the SMC reset L chip. So when I plug this in, as you can see, we get a green light on the charger. It's not going to turn on because SMC, they're not going to turn on just due to the fact that that the SMC is going to crash. We don't understand why Australia too. My $150 merch I ordered clearly marked as a gift item cost me $50 more just in tariff and handling fees. Yeah, screw tariffs. But as you can see here, after removing the SMC reset chip, we are getting a green light on the charger, and we're also getting 3.4 volts on SMC reset, meaning this is most likely a problem with SMC reset. So let me just get a replacement chip from a donor. Thank you, Anil, for this board that has already replaced SMC and a jagged-looking SMC reset chip. That's fine. We'll make it. Yeah, I'll just ask Apple to sell me one. That'll go great. All right, so we do this. And we're going to replace that chip with another one. And once this works, my accountant's assistant's machine will work, and hopefully he can go back to making sure that I don't get owned by the IRS. And yeah. Okay, do that. So hopefully you understand why it is that I checked PPBus G3HOT to confirm that the SMC was off, and I hope you understand why it is that 12.28 volts versus 12.56 volts means something to me. The chip that creates PPBus G3HOT communicates with the SMC, and this is where pattern recognition comes in handy, because I don't have a manual for this or anything like that. It's just that every single time that the SMC has been corroded or broken, or it's not working right, or it's not turning on, I get 12.28 versus when it works, I get 12.56. So I've associated in my head that when the system management controller is working, I will get 12.56 volts, and when it's not working, I'll get 12.28 volts. I need your quarterly filings, please, says IRS. What? Get out of here. Get the
fuck out of my store. We are closed. Get the fuck out of my store. We are closed.
Anyway, back to this. Let's see if this thing gives me fan spin now that we've replaced the SMC. Yeah, SMC reset LIC. And it works. Beautiful. Lovely. So now this machine works. Now we move on to some more important questions. Why are my company's finances being held on a MacBook?
They're not.
MacBook.
This is just for like generic stuff, not yet.
Like the shitty companies.
Yes.
Okay, just making sure.
The ones that aren't as complex or as special.
Okay. Can you hand this to one of the three people in the front and just say, Lewis asked if you could please reassemble this?
Okay, thank you.
And
so
it'll be set and working.
Great, thank you.
No more MacBook!
Well, you're
going
to have to tell him that.
I will, actually. Let's see. Where is my fucking phone? Yeah, what the hell? Who cares? Yeah. Her logic board died, comma. I fixed it live on stream, period. I am having the reassembly people put her machine back together first before the others so that you can get back to work, period. But let's get to a more serious question, period. Why the fuck are people at your business using a MacBook? ! I trust you with my finances and taxes! ! And you trust them to a Mac! ! You know, that's supposed to be a question mark. You kill me! ! Sad face. There was no liquid damage or drop damage on it, comma. It just died on its own, period, sad face. As Macs do, ! Oh. As the USPS supervisor pay taxes on $1,800 worth of products he gained. Don't remind me, that pisses me off. It's like every...
Can you just speedrun a board repair?
Speedrun?
Yeah.
What's that?
It's doing something as fast as possible.
Yes. Yes. I don't care what type of machine you use in your personal or business life. It really doesn't matter to me. Until you're the person in charge of my finances. That's when we draw the fucking line. A fucking MacBook. Are you kidding me? Alright. Where do you store Q-tips here? Oh, I should get my own bin, shouldn't I? I think my... Thank you. Okay, so we've removed all the underfill that really matters to me. Maybe we can get a little bit more off on the edge. Scraping this shit is a royal pain in the ass. And also, we gotta move this one pad back into place. See, this one, it tried to escape. Okay, let's get ourselves a replacement CD3215 from store.rossmangroup.com. Okay. Somebody earlier said to make sure I use the proper amount of flux, so let's just make sure the proper amount of flux gets used on this. What? Where'd you go? Oh, that don't know. There's no way you got sucked into the machine. The chip has fallen onto the floor.
That's $18.
That's $18. Here you are, you little fuck. Are you the same chip? Or are you an SMC? I guess one way to find out, I suppose. You're gonna be a franchise today. No, that's fine. It says CD3215 on it. It's got a little bit of dust. I'm sure all the balls are there just fine. Okay, now when I funny story about postal services, I ordered a phone from China. It safely traveled 5,500 miles across the globe, only to be lost, stolen on the last 50 miles between customs office and one of the depots on the way. Yeah. Yeah, that sucks. I'm sorry to hear that. So after I put the chip on the board, one of the things you may notice I do is I do this, a little bit of scraping and scratching, because I only want the chip to move the diameter of a single ball. So let's say that a single pad is this big, right? The chip itself should only move back and forth this much. If it moves more than that, then I know that it's not a line. That's how I can tell if it's aligned properly or not, which this clearly is. So we are going to solder it onto the board. Beautiful. Lewis, why are people who do BGA rework so rare? Well, it depends. What type of BGA rework do you mean? If you mean the type that, like, I do, I don't think it's that rare because it's required to do the job. Maybe it's rare to find people who fix boards because it's a difficult thing to learn, and up until very recently, there weren't a lot of resources teaching people how to work on these modern devices. If you mean BGA rework, like replacing CPUs, solder, Copaz, solder. If you're talking about GPU replacements and shit like that, it's because there's no money in it. Like one of the reasons there's a shortage of it is how do you make money doing that? So I'm gonna buy a chip on AliExpress for $60 to $80 that I most likely can't return if it doesn't work. I'm gonna spend an hour replacing your GPU only to find out that the GPU that I bought doesn't work. After spending $6,000 to $7,000 on the machinery to do it right, like no, it's not very profitable. So it really only works if you have a specific niche, you have a vendor that always sends you good stuff, and you know exactly what chips you can and can't buy from that vendor that are good. But yeah, of course they're not going to replace the GPU on an archaic ThinkPad. That's the other thing. If your ThinkPad is archaic, that means that you could buy another one for $100. So if you can buy a new ThinkPad for $100, and typically you have to charge 30% of the cost of something to make it something that somebody's going to be willing to fix, that means I need to do all that work for $33. I don't want to spend 1 or 2 or 3 hours of my time, you know, removing the chip properly, putting a new one on, reballing one, or going through 2 or 3 or 4 different chips to find the one vendor on AliExpress or eBay that's not selling me a fake for $33. It's just, you know, it genuinely makes very little to no financial sense to do, unless you're working on a specific machine that has a specific flaw, where you know that every single time you buy the specific chip from the specific vendor, they're actually selling you something good, not some shit they ripped off another machine and call new. So, yeah.
Were these always red?
Yes. On my other bike, they're silver.
Oh, that's why. I swear I've never seen silver ones.
Alright, so let's see what we get here. So we're getting 5.7 volts, and it's still boot looping. Yay. Oh, well, that's some horseshit.
Fixed?
No.
No.
Much. Still fucked. Well, ain't that some horseshit? Look, we have another one over here that has a red sticker. So this one has a red sticker, which means this probably got water on it at some point as well. Yay. Alright, we're going to do another CD3215 today. Today I had an iPhone 8 come up with muffled sound. Apple Store told the guy it was a broken microphone and quoted him $500. I cleaned the speaker mesh and it sounds great. That sounds like the Apple Store. It's interesting, on the other side, the charger is not boot looping. So on the side that has corrosion, the charger is not boot looping. But on the one that does not have corrosion, it is boot looping. Yeah, see, it's taking 20 milliamps at 5 volts, but it's staying on steady. Whereas on the other side of the board, that's genuinely interesting to me. I like my P50. What's wrong with yours, wash machine? Thermal cam? Oh, I have to steal from Camille. Sometimes the thermal cam will tell you which CD3215 is causing looping.
What's the other side though?
The side that has corrosion is 5 volts steady. The side that's perfectly clean is looping. So you work?
You wanna wait to see if
it loops? Oh, yeah, the other one boot loops way faster than that. You work? Well, it's two of them. These two both boot loop on the side that has no corrosion. Yep. You loop. Boo. Okay. Let's do a... Let's see what happens if we replace this other one that looks a little corroded. Even... Oh, when I sent my P50 into Lenovo for repair, it came back with no working collimator washman. Okay, somebody said that the cap to the lower left corner looked cracked. No, that's not a crack capacitor. That is underfill over the capacitor. Remember Chris's underfill around the chip? Yes. No.
No?
No. Yeah, you gotta use a C00 on most of them for it to work. Why?
But we have a B01 on a board. Can we use a C00 on it?
I think you can use a C00 where a B01 was, but not the other way around.
The other way?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Clinton is getting a new present on Wednesday. Clinton will be very happy to show it on camera, Adam. I have so many boxes at my apartment at the moment, though. I had the cleaning lady come this morning. So hopefully when I go home, it's going to be less nasty. My home has really not felt like a home recently. Too much work. Indeed I do, Mega Mock. See how that cap on top tried to get away? Is tourist season already over? There's no such thing as an end to tourist season. There are always tourists. And they come and they do touristy things. A pad just flew away. Let's see what that pad is for. One, two, three, four, five. Ah, thank God, not connected. All right, schematic says that the pad that is ripped is not connected to anything. That's good.
That cap can suck it. Optional. Okay, we're going to get ourselves another CD3215. Yes, there is, Sensei. Connect to iTunes and update. There's also a solder blob by the diode I got to get out of there. Why doesn't gravity work when I want it to? There we go. Now we get another chip. All right, we're back. Yeah, I have squelch turned on, but for some reason it doesn't seem to be working, and I haven't had the time to research why. It's supposed to squelch and not play noise when there's no signal or a low signal, but it doesn't do that, obviously, judging by your comments. Alright, it just settled into place. Oh, that's just bullshit. It's especially bullshit because this side is clean, except for those solder balls around. Wait a second. What are you solder balls doing there? Why are there solder balls there? What chip is this? That's a diode on incoming, it seems. Yeah, that's a diode to ground. I don't think that chip is bad, I just think this is bad production. Let's just see if there's a short to ground on that side, which I doubt there is, but if there was, this wouldn't be turning on. I mean, or not even not turning on, I mean, it wouldn't even be giving us 5 volts. Yeah, 7. Wait, 700 ohms to ground, that's kind of funkily low. No, because the other side that's not boot looping is 500 ohms to ground. So what the heck is up with this side that's making it give us this funny reading? I still... I still find this strange, because this is the only one that was genuinely corroded. And the corroded nasty nastiness over here on this other one was only around a pull-down resistor to ground for a debug. Yeah, like two debug resistors are pulled. Boot looping. So the two CD3215s on the side that was actually corroded have been replaced. And the side that is boot looping is the side with perfectly clean ones. I find this difficult to believe. The side with the messed up ones that will replace. It's there in chills. The B3V3 underscore G3 Huck continues to be present.
I have a feeling I'm going to replace the other two CD3215s, and it's still not going to work. So if any one of these CD3215s doesn't work, then the machine's not going to work, but the corrosion was only on this side. So I don't see how replacing these two is going to do anything. This is probably going to be some much more deep-seated problem. This is going to be a rabbit hole, so I can either... A, one of the CD3215s I put on is bad, so I could have to replace those two, and that's no fun. Or B, it somehow magically destroyed the CD3215 on the other side of the board, which I'm not buying it, but if I had a guess, I'd say this one because there were solder blobs on it. So I'm going to go ahead and be a monkey and replace the CD3215s on the opposite side of the board as well, because that is really all that's I can imagine at this point. Well, that could be wrong, but... prior to doing that, I'm going to order myself a burrito, because I think at this point I deserve one. I don't think I deserve one, actually, because I didn't fix the board. But I kind of want one anyway. I fixed the freebie one for my account. I need to fix the money one. Okay, let's dive in. I got myself a burrito. That would be funny, JP. Many people would likely curse at that. That's kind of what makes it funny. So now I'm, at this point I realize this board is a waste of time, but I'm going to continue with it. This should give you an example of when you should probably give up. I'm continuing with it because I believe it should be easy to solve. And because I believe it should be easy to solve, I'm ignoring the reality that it's not going to be easy to solve, because the problem makes no sense. And that stubbornness is going to be why I torture myself on this. Well, I need something to do, I suppose, while I'm waiting for the food to get here. But this is going to be a waste of time, you'll see. And the reason I'm going for this one first is because I saw solder balls near it. That's not a burn, that's underfill. It's the color of the underfill. You think it's a burn cap, but it's just underfill. And we're getting 3.3 volts at that cap, which means it's fine, unlike the cap that I just stabbed with my iron. That cap needs flow session, though. Okay, let's do some more janitorial work. Clean up an aisle CD3215. Make room for the chip. What's a somebody got me a kitty thing.
Yeah.
Oh, cool. Leave it here. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. Guess how many flies flew into that mosquito thing, by the way.
What happened?
Guess how many flies flew into that mosquito killer.
30.
None. My cat actually plays with it, but the flies ignore it. They actually sit on top of it, but they never go into the bulb.
Yeah. So you don't put like sugar water or something or around
it? I haven't tried that. Yeah, I got this fly killer from my place. It's some like UV light zapper thingy. And the flies ignore it entirely. They laugh at it. As you can see, the not connected pad that always comes off came off on the bottom. No big deal. I don't give a shit about the not connected pad. I'm trying really hard here to put my pressure on the outside where this rubbish underfill is. How's your hand healing, Anel?
Great.
Okay. That should be good. Now we're going to clean it up a little bit so we can put a new chip on. That is not going to work. Yep, that's the not connected pad that always disappears. Uh-oh. And I got to run a jumper. Oh, well. Whoops. One jumper. It doesn't matter, because it's not going to work after I run that jumper anyway. The underfill isn't really there to troll repair shops. It's there to keep the stuff from breaking. It just so happens to not really actually serve that function in this particular instance. Okay, now I'm pretty sure that this micro pencil is dead. Also, it's tangled to hell and back. Jesus Christ. So let's see if this micro pencil can actually work. So this is plugged into source. Oh, whoa. You work? Beep? Beep? Well, I'll be. Let's see what happens here. Wait a second. You're dead. You're plugged into source. I got hit S. You fucking piece of shit. Alright, yeah. Dead. Alright, let's see if another tip does it. Thank you.
Fresh one.
Ooh. Source? Thank you. I have a fresh tip. Well, you're very nice to this fresh tip. Fresh tip of Bel Air. Okay, gonna take a nice little wire. I want to follow the angle of the trace.
Yeah. Stay still, mofo. God, where'd you go? My wire disappeared. Oh yeah, these tweezers are bent. I destroyed these tweezers. I made these tweezers humble. These tweezers are fucking shit. I'm better off using my hand. Alright. I'll use a screwdriver. Fuck it. A screwdriver will do. Okay, I give up. Time to steal somebody's tweezers.
You forgot I see.
Sorry. I pretty much gave you the best price. Salesman. Do you have tweezer here? New tweezer? Old tweezer? I'll take any set. Wow, you have a pouch of tweezers.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
I took it from home actually.
Are those yours? Let's see. Oh, thank you. No, I don't, if I take yours, I'll never give them back. You shouldn't let me have.
Actually, all right, think about it. If you want.
You know what, to recap, I can get this computer up and running for you for $650 with everything.
Plus tax, so $650 plus tax. Keyboard, screen Look at how easy proper tweezers make this whole job. Uh-oh. What have I done? What? Screwdriver, do your job. Peace. Okay. Now clean it up. Hey, stop that. Go back down. Good. Stay. Some green goo. Let's clean off the end of my X-Acto knife so I can use it to apply green shit. You can get green shit at store.rossmangroup.com. Don't delay. Use green goo to waste your time on a board that you already knew 30 minutes ago was unfixable today. Okay, we got some green shit. Okay, we don't want it to cover this pad, so I gotta scrape it off of that. And don't look at the screen, this is UV. UV is no good for you. Everybody, look away from your monitor if you want to avoid the UV rays. You've been warned. Don't look at your monitor. Your monitor is going to be emitting UV right now. You have been warned. Burrito?
Oh, no, it's
not mine. Oh, where's my... Okay, we clean, and now we're going to put a chip on that's not going to work. Yay. Okay, let's get our chip. And after we've replaced every single CD3215, this board is going to go to Paul. Once we've done all the hard work, I'm sure he'll do the easy part of figuring out why it doesn't turn on. Just put a tiny amount of flux there. I'm also going to try to flow that cap into place in the lower left that got away earlier. What? What the? Today's not my day. I'm getting owned like a noob. Board's not going up in no flames. What do you take this for, my bike? Okay, I just found something that completely nullifies most of the work I'm doing now. Remember when I said on the left side of the board that the charge port wasn't screwed in? And that gave me an idea that this was gonna suck? Well, there's something else too. Check this out. What the fuck is this? You're sitting up, you're not even on the board. Do you see what I see? Look at this. It's ripped. The sensor chip. When they were removing the bottom cover from the board, they ripped the left sensor. It's hovering. Oh, wow. I wish I saw that. I would have sent this shit right back. Oh, that sucks. Yep, it's still boot loops, and I'm done. Because if I saw that from the beginning, I wouldn't have even bothered with all this. This board is a waste. Thank you. Just in time for the burrito. Can't you replace it? Yeah, but that's not the thing. See, this is failed in a strange way that they don't usually fail. It's failed in a way that's going to be a real waste of time to figure it out. And if I see that you screwed with it and that you made it miserable, it's not worth it. I invested too much into it as is.
Paul Q. Paul. With that, I'm going to enjoy my burrito, and as always, I hope you learned something.